y'all. Well, I'm Crystal, and I just want to know something really quick. Have you ever seen American Ninja Warrior? If you have or if you haven't, I just want you to know, I absolutely love it. I was kind of late to the show, but I'm sure making up for lost time. I got all the episodes recorded on my TV, and I do not miss an episode. So if you have seen it or if you haven't, it's an obstacle course challenge where athletes all over the world come to compete to get through a variety of jumps, swings, rope challenges just to get to the red buzzer at the end of the course. One of my favorite competitors is a weatherman, and he looks totally normal. Listen, he crushes the course, he makes it look super simple, and so simple that when I watch him, I think to myself, Crystal, you can definitely do it. If the weatherman can do it, you can do it too. I wonder why some competitors can't get very far, why they fall when others fly through. I think if given the chance, I can probably do better. But then I think back at a story one time where I was taking my nephews to the park. And I remember there were some monkey bars there, and they were like, Auntie, Auntie, let's race on the monkey bars. Let's do the best out of three. And so I was like, absolutely. I knew I was gonna beat these 8-year-old boys on these monkey bars because I have a longer reach, and I just knew that I was better. So I started climbing and swinging from each bar, and then I thought, well, it'll be quicker if I can just skip some of the bars. So I tried to skip the bars, and I don't know what happened. I can't even tell you, but I fell right on my knees, and all I can see is these little 8-year-olds laughing hysterically. So what I realized is being an American Ninja Warrior is way harder than it looks. And I'm about to take a quick left turn. You know what else is harder than what it looks and sounds? Forgiveness. And that's what we're gonna be talking about today. And it sounds pretty straightforward. It's easy to say, I forgive you. And forgiveness is easy to talk about. You can go to your group tonight and have a discussion about forgiveness, and the discussion will be easy for you. You understand the idea of forgiveness. You know when someone hurts you in some way, you should forgive them. That's why we shouldn't hold grudges. You know you should let them off the hook and not try to pay them back for what they did to you. We all get that. And if you have siblings, you really get it. Your parents probably drilled it into your head. So no, it's not a new concept for you. This isn't anything you've never heard before, but just like the monkey bars at the park for me, or a full American Ninja Warrior course, it's a lot easier said than done. Because forgiveness is super easy until you have to do it. And that creates two problems for us. The first is when we resist forgiveness, it's hard to love our friends, or anyone of that matter, because people require forgiveness. That's part of being human. People will hurt your feelings, say things they shouldn't, do things they shouldn't, and when we don't forgive, love isn't possible. But that's not all. The second thing is, not forgiving makes it hard to follow Jesus, because forgiveness, as we'll see, was a big, big deal to him. It's one of the main things he asked us to do if we're gonna call ourselves followers of Jesus. Jesus knew we couldn't skip this, which is why Jesus told stories about forgiveness and modeled forgiveness for us. He knew even if we understood the idea of it, we would still struggle to do it. I mean, I struggle daily. The good news, though, is he hasn't asked us to do anything he wasn't willing to do himself. Jesus knew what it was like to hurt. He knew it was painful when people do you wrong. He knew forgiveness is easy to understand and difficult to carry out. And he knows it's tougher than what it seems, because he's done it all. But his followers knew forgiveness was a challenge too. That's why Peter, one of his 12 disciples, and one of the three that was especially close to Jesus, asked Jesus in Matthew 18 and 21, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to 7 times? Peter is aware that forgiveness is difficult, which is why he keeps asking just how much is required of him and no more. He wants to know just how responsible he has to be let off the hook. It's like when your coach tells you that you are going to run, your first question is something like, how far? How long? When will the pain stop? Running is hard. And believe me, I get that. It's tiring. And you want to know, when will the pain end? Forgiveness is just like that. Peter wanted to know when it could be over. Forgiveness is super, super challenging. And Peter wants to know how far he has to run with this forgiveness stuff. It's like he wants to know how close can he get to the line without actually crossing it. He's asking, can I stop after 7 times? And Peter thinks he is actually going up and beyond by suggesting 7 times. It seems like a good number, huh? When Peter attempts to make himself look good in front of the other guys to get Jesus to say to him, Peter, wow, you are so spiritually holy. Good job, buddy. So you can imagine Peter's surprise when Jesus responds by saying, I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. Listen, I can only imagine what Peter is thinking. Like, what? The good news is Jesus didn't actually mean we forgive someone literally 77 times. But the bad news is he had something much bigger in mind. So Jesus tells a story. We'll pick up right here in Matthew 18 and 23. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back everything. The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. And just so we're clear, 10,000 bags of gold is like millions of dollars today. So this wasn't pocket change. And the ones listening to this story know that. And they are sitting there going, that is wild. He just forgave the whole debt. What would you feel if right now you owed somebody $1.5 million and you didn't have the money to pay them back? And they wanted it now and they were going to arrest you. And if you were consumed with this debt, all you would think about and worry about is how were you going to repay it? It's all consuming. So when the king told the guy that the debt was canceled and he never owed him anything, the weight off his shoulders would have been astounding. And we expect that he could be incredibly impacted by his gift. We expect that he would be incredibly impacted by this because that's such a gift. Like that is super life-changing stuff. I'm still waiting for someone to do that to me. You don't ever forget moments like this. But that's not the end of the story. Jesus continues. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. Right there, you know what this guy's supposed to do. Easy answer, right? Given how much he was just forgiven, what would have been over $1 million in our time? Of course, he would forgive this teeny tiny 100 silver coins. So you may be asking, what happened next? He grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, be patient with me and I will pay it back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. You see, obviously we thought the story would go a little bit different because forgiveness made sense. But I'm telling you, just because we understand what should happen with forgiveness doesn't mean it's easy for us. It makes sense, but forgiveness is super hard. The parable makes it very clear, but Jesus didn't let us off the hook just because it's difficult. Check out his point as he closes out the story. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said. I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. The owner is like, come on, man. This was simple. You knew what you were supposed to do. You just didn't do it. I showed you what to do. I forgave you way more than you had to forgive. And then Jesus does something so crazy. He drops the bomb, and for some of us, he drops the mic on Peter and the rest of us who are reading. This is how my Heavenly Father would treat each of you, unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart. So what exactly does Jesus mean by this? Remember, this is a parable. This doesn't mean we are literally put in jail and tortured when we don't forgive someone. So what does it mean? Think about the last time you held onto a grudge. The last time you refused to let go of something someone did to you. Did it hurt the person you were mad at or refusing to forgive? Probably not. Did it hurt you? Absolutely, because refusing to forgive is its own kind of punishment and torture. When we refuse to forgive, just like the parable was showing us, we are ultimately hurting ourselves, imprisoning ourselves until we are able to see that what we have been forgiven was just as big as what we are being asked to forgive. So back to Peter's question, is forgiving 7 times enough? Listen, I don't think so. Because if you are keeping track, it means you still haven't let it go. You've forgiven enough when you are free. The point isn't to make God happy by forgiving more times, but to make you whole. But that's not all. The point of the story is also to shift attention from what was done to us that we need to forgive to what we have done that God has already forgiven. Because it's a lot easier to hold onto a grudge when you see yourself as blameless. But when our eyes are open to the ways we also have missed the mark, showing grace becomes much easier. And let's be clear, Jesus has forgiven us a lot. I know he's forgiven me a ton. He's forgiven everyone so much. Every lustful thought, every secret sin, every lie, every addiction, every unkind word that we have said, every hateful thought, every anger outburst, every violent crime, every crime committed by a criminal, he has forgiven. Forgiveness becomes a little easier in light of the enormous debt God has forgiven us. We will never be able to pass along forgiveness to others when we are unwilling to see how often we have messed up. As long as we think we are better than someone else and their mistakes against us, forgiveness will be a tough thing for us to demonstrate. And the thing we need to remember most is just like the parable points out, it's all connected. Our ability to forgive others is directly tied to our willingness to receive forgiveness. And we can't expect forgiveness from others if we aren't willing to give it as well. For many of us in the church, we have to remind ourselves that we are not as great as we think we are sometimes. Our pride may be the biggest thing that keeps us from passing on forgiveness to others. Our judgmental spirit cuts others so deep to the core that sometimes it's unbearable. Our secret sins are bigger than we can even admit. Our attitude towards our parents would surprise a lot of people. Our envy and jealousy may not show itself on the outside, but if we can all be honest, we know that it's brewing on the inside daily. We have a pile of sin that Jesus is willing to forgive over and over and over again. And I tell you that not so you start hating yourself, but so you realize what Jesus has already forgiven you of, and to empower you to pass it along to someone else, to remind you that Jesus had led the way in this and we can follow his cue. Remember, freedom is found when you can give forgiveness and receive it. And here's what you need to know. You have already been forgiven. God has taken what you have done and he has gotten rid of it. But for you to fully experience freedom, you need to be willing to forgive what was done to you. Forgiveness is easy until you have to do it. But God forgives big and challenges us to forgive like we've been forgiven. It's not that easy. And chances are it's not a one-time thing. It will be something you would do over and over again for the same offense and for some other offenses too. The point is, when we work hard at forgiving others, we are making it more likely to appreciate the forgiveness extended to us from God. And when we appreciate the forgiveness from God, we are more likely to forgive others. So we all need to forgive like we have been forgiven. It allows us the most amount of freedom. So when it comes to forgiveness, let it go and pass it on.